Hi everyone. For this hands-on project, we worked with low-fat data trying to study some properties of the interstellar medium. And the advisor was Andrea Bracco, and these are the team. This is the team. So just before I get into it, I'll give you a recap about what Faraday rotation is. This red source here can be any source emitting polarized emission, such as a pulsar or an extragalactic quasar. And if it passes through a medium that has free electrons and a line of sight magnetic field, then it can rotate the polarization vector. The amount by which it rotates is given by the rotation measure, and it depends on the square of the wavelength. And this rotation measure can give us some insights about the electron density and the magnetic field of this intervening medium. So the interstellar medium is such a Faraday rotating medium. So if we can measure the rotation measure, and if we have an idea of either of the electron density or the magnetic field, then we can try to estimate the another quantity. However, the ISM can be quite complex, and it can emit polarized emission itself. I mean, this medium does not have to be homogeneous, but this relation assumes that it's homogeneous. So how do we disentangle different emissions coming out from different parts of the interstellar medium? What we do is known as Faraday tomography. First, we perform a rotation measure synthesis, which is done by generalizing the rotation measure to a new quantity called Faraday depth. And then we go from wavelength space to Faraday depth space. Let me explain in detail now. So we have this data from low far, at very low frequency. And this is the polarized intensity cube. So on the y-axis, you have declination, x-axis RA, and on the z-axis, we have wavelength or frequency. So what we do is do a Fourier transform of this, and then go from wavelength space to a Faraday depth space. So we get another cube, which is again, this is all quite similar to what we use in spectroscopy. So now we got this. What does this physically mean? Now we can look at one particular pixel and look through the line of sight and get a spectra, extract a spectra, and this is what we got here. So what this tells us is that there is one polarized emission, one source emitting polarized emission here with Faraday depth about minus 16, and there are some other sources around 0 radian per meter square. So if there is a single source, you'll only see a single peak, but if there are multiple Faraday rotating sources, then you'll see multiple peaks. Of course, one can also look through a video of it. Here also, you'll see different sources of varying sizes, from point sources to large scale emissions. This is again very similar to what we do in spectroscopy. Another way to get some physical intuition about what's going on and identify some parameters is the moment maps. So the moment zero is simply the total linearly polarized intensity. And you can see some point sources and then the diffuse emission, which is generally coming from the galaxy itself and not the extragalactic quasar. And then the moment one map, it gives you the average Faraday depth. Here, there's a lot of noise. We should have masked it, but we didn't get time to do so. But what this identifies is the direction of the magnetic field. If it is positive, it means the direction of the magnetic field points towards us, and if it's negative, it's away from us. So in this general region, one can say the magnetic field on average is pointing towards us. And then the moment two maps will tell you the variance of the polarized intensity. So you can see some linear features which are similar to what we saw in moment zero maps. Now if I place them all at the same here, you can see that here in moment zero map, there are some linear features which have less polarized intensity than their surroundings. We can call them depolarized. Now on the moment map, it tells you that the variance is high. It means that there are many structures at different Faraday depths giving rise to these depolarized emissions. These are known as Faraday ghosts or depolarization canals. And this occurs because there are multiple ionized clumps, each of them rotating the polarization vector in its own way. And then adding them all up, they can get depolarized. So the takeaway I would tell you is that if you are looking at polarization, you need to take care of foreground, galactic foreground emission, especially at low radio frequencies. And then if you want to identify where are in Faraday depth, where are these different emissions, you can do rotation measure synthesis. Thank you. And if you have any questions, I'll take them now.
Thank you. So there is a question in the chat. There seems to be some linear stretch in your moment zero map. Is it real structure or other things?
Sorry, is it real structure? Yeah, these are known as the Faraday ghosts, as I explained here, or depolarization canals. These are real features.
So those linear stretch are real structure? Okay. Okay, thank you. And otherwise, I'm just curious, maybe I missed it. Is there a limit in density of the ISM where you can do this kind of studies?
I'm sorry, what do you mean limit intensity?
I mean, what is basically the range of ISM density where you can apply this kind of diagnostics?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I mean, the moment one map will tell us about the magnetic field direction, but about NE, I don't know.
Okay. Thank you. So there is another question which just appeared. What is the physical nature of these very thin ghost structures?
It's not very clear, but as far as I know, these come from different NE, the variance due to NE and B fields, magnetic fields. So they can be, each of them rotates the polarization vector in its own way. And because of that, if there is 90 degree separation, then they get canceled. And this is the depolarization. And where exactly do these come from? One can maybe guess that it's due to turbulent magnetic fields, you know, because of the small scale structures, but I don't know much more than that.
Okay, thank you.